Denver 8 TV, your city, your source.
They say a society can be judged by how they care for their children. And in Denver, that care is exemplified by the work of the Third Way Center, a place for troubled teens to find truth and hope. Its founder, Dr. Hildegard Messenbaugh, joins DA Mitch Morrissey on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks. Mitch, good to see you again.
Good to see you, Tamara.
And we have a really unique and wonderful guest this time around, as we always do, but especially today, Dr. Hildegard Messenbaugh. You were joking how long it takes to sign your autograph and
it's
your
a
signature. So I want to get started to put the whole conversation into context a little bit about your background, and I know there's a lot of rich history behind there. Tell us originally where you're from and how you got to the U.S.
It took a long time to get here. I was born in Yugoslavia just before World War II, and then had to flee from the Bolsheviks into Austria. And unfortunately, the Nazis didn't think we were Germans and put us into camps and tried to kill us. And eventually ran out of gas, and we were dropped off in different towns, and I grew up in a little town called Saalfelden am Steinen und Meer, which was quite a mouthful too, isn't it? And we had no clue where that was either. But I grew up there, and when the Americans came, and I was lucky enough to be in the American sector, my father applied for a visa to the U.S. and then died. Took several, many more years before we even paid attention to that visa. And when I was a teenager and in boarding school, we got an invitation to come to America once again. And I ended up in Rochester, New York, where I went to college and to medical school. When girls didn't go to medical school, never occurred to me girls couldn't go to medical school. And I had a fabulous professor who was a psychiatrist, and I got very much interested in psychiatry, and had patients assigned to me happened to be teenagers, and it occurred to me that it didn't seem like work. So I've been with teens ever since.
So you have a special place in your heart for teens.
I do. I like them very much. I think they're funny. I think they're very sad. And I think I help them get out of teenagehood as fast as possible.
Talk to us about the Third Way Center. What is that?
Well, Third Way Center is such a 60s name, and it was founded in the 60s. It was a time when kids were on the street. Zillions of kids were on the street. I don't think you're old enough to remember that, but there were zillions of children on the street. And so there were lots and lots of drop-in places for kids, and that sprung up everywhere. And I was working at the University of Colorado Medical Center at the time, and the Church of Christ out in Wheat Ridge sent a minister to us to ask whether we could help them establish a runaway place that was more psychiatrically oriented. And since I had been in the community before, having helped start the clinic in Aspen, they looked at me and said, Hildegard? And so by sheer happenstance, I came to be associated with it, and was lucky enough to get the support of the university to staff the place and to develop it and to be able to write a program for it. And I've been with it ever since.
What exactly do you do for the children?
Well, the program slowly evolved from being a runaway center just for kids with off the streets to give them a safe place to be, to slowly becoming a treatment center. And then as it became clearer and clearer that trauma was the major issue that drove these kids to act out, we became more and more interested in dealing with trauma and learning how to heal trauma, mm-hmm. kids who were severely traumatized.
And why the term Third Way?
Isn't that a third? That is such a 60s thing.
Is it?
Yeah, yes, it is. We were all hippies then.
Were you a hippie?
Oh, God, yes, I was.
I kind of believe that.
Oh, yeah.
We'll do another show on that.
I'll show you pictures. No, I won't. I won't. But we were thinking that it was a difference between being either on the streets or being in a psychiatric hospital. Of course, then the psychiatric hospitals all went out of style. They all closed in the 90s. And we became the psychiatric hospitals, really, of the 2000s. And somewhere along the line in 93, 94, treatment shifted from the hospitals onto the RTCs, to the residential treatment centers. And we then became increasingly more so a treatment center, a psychiatric treatment center, rather than just a placement.
So Mitch, what kind of role does organizations like Dr. Messenbaugh's play in the work that you do in prosecuting young people?
Well, so many of the people that we see, not even necessarily young people, you can see why they behave the way they do, that gets them into the criminal justice system based on trauma they experienced young in their young lives. And, you know, Hildegard hit it right on the point. That the institutions that used to deal with this, and people can argue how they did, are gone. And one of the only institutions that's left is the criminal justice system. And then we're asked as prosecutors, police officers, probation officers, those types of things, to deal with people that have severe psychological issues, that have drug addiction, that have all of the things that really should be handled by a professional like this. And so when I'm in a situation where I need somebody, or somebody's been sentenced but they are severely psychotic or in trouble in mental health ways, they get sent to the Third Way Center. And they may be kids that have been through horrible abuse, and that's why they're acting out now. They go to the Third Way Center. They get the skills they need then to take care of themselves, take care of their community, and survive on through being teenagers into being adults. And they learn that independence that they're going to need to make it in the world.
Because if they don't figure it out now, at that age, they're going to grow up to be maybe professional criminals, for lack of a better term.
As the private sector got eliminated by managed care, and it became increasingly less profitable to deal with mental illnesses in children, particularly in adolescents, it shifted that responsibility first to the public sector, which I'm mostly talking about social services. As that became more and more managed care oriented also, and the dollars got shorter and shorter, the entire burden of treating mentally ill children and teenagers then fell on the juvenile justice system.
Mm-hmm. And then?
And there's nothing really in the juvenile justice system that is prepared for that, I don't think. Do you?
Well, Denver.
I think John Gomez has made tremendous progress with that. I think he's done fabulous work in trying to get treatment to come to the juvenile justice system, to recognizing that what country locks up their children, tell me.
Mm. Was it on that note, was it hard to get support for this idea, this notion?
No, I don't think so. I've never really thought about it, to tell you the truth. We have grown very steadily. I started Third Way, I borrowed $2,000 from a friend whom I saw in the hall at the University of Colorado Medical Center and said, you have $2,000, Ken? He was a banker, and he said, for what? And I said, I want to start a treatment center for teenagers on the streets, and he wrote me a check. It was supposed to be a loan. It never was repaid. He said it was his best investment, and he never asked for his money back. God bless him. And that has grown into, we now have 9 houses and a freestanding high school in an administrative building. I think it grew because the necessity was there.
How many young people do you have in the
We program? Have about 110 kids in the system at any given time.
That's making a big impact.
Yes, it is. It's a lot of kids because 110 children are attached to 110 parents, mm-hmm. who are attached to 110 other people, who are attached to 110 social workers and caseworkers and client managers. The number of people is exponential, really, when you think about when you treat a kid. You're not just treating the kid, you're treating an entire system.
What are some of the circumstances that would bring a child to you?
Most of our children are referred through the courts, either through their client managers and some of them through social services. Occasionally we get private referrals, but they're very rare. For the most part, they are kids that have been really in an unbelievable number of systems before. I have treated kids who've been in 50, 60 treatment centers. They're 17 years old. Imagine yourself having to move 50 times from place to place, from foster home to treatment centers, to residential treatment centers, to psychiatric hospitals, to the jail, to back to foster homes. Another foster home. It is like a revolving door for them.
And what does that do for that child's
psyche?
Well,
they're not happy. They're pretty angry by the time they arrive.
Unstable.
They're furious. They're mean. They have given up a long time ago. And they think you are very stupid and we're very stupid. And they're very, and to some extent, it's been so long since they've been able to deal with what really troubles them that they're kind of reluctant to do that, do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And it's hard to establish some kind of relationship with them and to reach out to them because they bite you.
Yeah.
And they're not very likable, so getting a lot of empathy for them is difficult. That part is difficult in the community. People understand that these very, very sick kids eat up the vast majority of public service money, and they're angry about that. But it's not like they do it on purpose.
Right.
And shifting the responsibility just into the adult system isn't going to be the answer either.
Mm-hmm. They just get worse.
And they get worse and they get less treatable. I think adolescence is a fabulous time to treat kids because when you're a teenager, you're pretty crazy anyway. And you're kind of open. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Right.
Development has made you open. Teenagers are very open creatures. It's very confusing time for them anyway. It's a wonderful time to step in, to confuse them even more, and to get back to what is really the trouble with them.
Yeah. Lots of layers to peel back, I imagine.
Yeah. But they're more willing to pull the layers back mm-hmm. in adolescence, I think, than they are, either as children when they don't have the verbal skills, and certainly much more so than adults. The parents are much more difficult to treat than the children are.
Do you work with the parents too?
Oh, yes, absolutely. A child is always attached to the parents. My favorite saying to my staff is that mothers always win, because mothers always do win.
Yeah. Well, we're going to talk more with you in just a moment. We're talking about the Third Way Center with Dr. Messenbaugh. We'll be right back on Dialogue Denver DA.
Forget that moment.
That changed my life.
At that moment, it hit me. This is why I joined the Guard. We're soldiers, always ready to protect our country. But we've also got communities. Family, friends, neighbors who count on us. I couldn't believe it. I just saved a life. Somebody from my hometown.
See what it means to be a citizen soldier at NationalGuard.com.
Welcome back to Dialogue Denver DA with Mitch Morrissey. I'm Tamara Banks. This is the part of the show where we get to talk about a legal term, a really fun part of the show. This term today is sequester, and the definition is to separate. Sometimes juries are separated from outside influences during their deliberations, such as during a highly publicized trial. And Mitch, this is real important to make sure that the jury is really not influenced by the media, for example.
Well, a jury is instructed at the beginning of a trial that your job is to hear the evidence that comes in through the courtroom, through the testimony of the witnesses, through the exhibits and things that they see as evidence, and not to be influenced by any outside sources. So they're told not to talk to their families about what they're hearing. They're told not to watch TV, to not read in the newspaper if there's a story about it. They're not investigators. Their job is the finder of fact. So sequestration, if people have seen it on movies, for instance, they'll put the jury in a hotel. and there's a bailiff and people making sure that they don't have any outside influences. And we used to actually do that in Denver. When I first started 30 years ago, we did the last sequestered jury in a murder case that was done in Colorado. Now we do it through court order, the judge constantly reminding them of what their role is. Every time there's a break, don't go on the internet and look for things about this. Don't do any of that. They get to go home, they don't stay in hotels.
Right.
But then when they actually deliberate, that's when they're kept together, we take away their cell phones, they're in the jury room, when they go to lunch, they're taken to lunch by the bailiff to make sure nobody influences them. They do get to go home at night, but again with that same discharge instruction about how they're supposed to behave. Mm-hmm. The idea being to be a fair, impartial juror. They have to do and base their decision on what they hear in the courtroom.
It's a real important piece of the law. So getting back to our guest today, Dr. Messenbaugh, talking about Third Way Center, some people I think would be shocked to realize that children as young as 10 years old can be incarcerated. How does that make you feel?
It makes me feel terrible. It makes me feel absolutely awful. It isn't fair. It isn't right. I don't think we should punish children. Children learn from us. If you're going to have a child misbehave, I think the most logical question to ask that child, it seems to me anyway, is where did you learn that from? And who taught you that? Because no child decides to become a sexual perpetrator without being taught. That simply isn't in the developmental process of a child. So they must have learned from somebody, sometime, somewhere.
And so you've had a conversation with our district attorney about this, haven't you, once or twice?
Several conversations.
Well, we have.
And, about you know, this subject.
We've talked about it. And actually, the good news is the one young child that did get incarcerated in the situation that we're talking about ended up at Third Way Center. He is currently there. But over time, I have taken some risks as a district attorney. And one of the biggest risks I took is that we had a 10-year-old. We had prosecuted the perpetrator, who was an uncle. We had put him in the penitentiary. He was sexually assaulting this little boy, who was 10. Mm. And then the little boy started acting out sexually. And the lucky thing there was the family of the even littler child wanted something done differently than what is normally done, and that's charging the person and putting the person in the juvenile system and letting the judge and probation officers and all of those people decide what's going to happen to them. So I went to Hildegard and said, this is a 10-year-old. What can you do? What can we do? And she said, in my program, my kids, my clients, they'll eat this little kid up. Mm-hmm. He's too little to come into my program. But I will give you some advice. Here are the people to go talk to. Put him in your diversion program. Don't charge him. Put him in that program. Let him learn empathy for himself as a victim. And how that, what he did impacted the other little one. And, you know, for my diversion program, it was a new step in a new direction because we just take property offenders there. Mm-hmm. And we specialized a program for him based on the advice that we got. He's through that program, and he made it. And we never had to reinitiate charges. The interesting thing is, while we were trying to get this built, I had to charge him. And then when I went to dismiss the case, they told my deputy, well, you can't do this. You can't dismiss this case. He needs to be with us. He needs to be in this system. And we were like, tell them to call me if they think I can't dismiss a case. We are going to try something new and different, and I never would have done it without Hildegard's advice, without trusting her to know that this is somebody that will do this in the right direction. That boy has made it through. And as a public elected official, if he would have failed and somebody would have said, well, look what Morrissey did, I would have said he was 10. Yeah. He was 10. What were our options? I tried something. He fails, he ends up in that same system. Mm-hmm. But we're going to try something different, and I'm doing it on the advice of a trusted person that I know is an expert in this area, and that's why I did it. We currently have two young girls in that situation. So we have, the public defenders love it. They call it our pilot project. I intended to do it for that boy, but then when two others came to our attention, we did it that way. So my hope is that if the circumstances are right, we won't see the 10-year-old that goes to the Department of Youth Services out of Denver and ends up at Third Way Center when he's 15, mm-hmm. and desperately needed the same kind of services that she helped us get for this other 10-year-old when he needed it the most, when he was 10.
How is he doing now? What is
he's
his...
made it. He made it through the program. Not only did he make it through the program, I've seen all the letters that he's written to the victim about how he understood what he did, how he understands the impact of that. The other thing was, I said, is he paying for the therapy for the younger child? And they said, well, no, we don't have him in our arts program. I said, put him in the arts program. Make him, you know, make art pieces like we've talked about, mm-hmm. to sell to the public to pay for that. Now, of course, he can't pay for all of it. And we were already paying for treatment for him because he was the victim of this adult perpetrator. So Hildegard opened my eyes and made me take a risk, and I took it, and it worked.
But you
now
didn't...
it won't always work.
Well,
but...
yeah, it does. I disagree with you, because one of the reasons you took the risk is because we've been doing this for 20 years, and in 20 years, I have never had a reoffender.
Wow.
Now, that's a pretty amazing thing. And she didn't believe me, and we had to search the system just to be sure that I was telling the truth.
And how many young people?
Hundreds.
Wow.
Well, thousands, I would think.
Well, ultimately, we treated
years.
Thousands of them, but offenders, hundreds and hundreds of juvenile offenders. I've treated sex offenders. And we started this a long time ago. Since then, there's lots of research that shows that if you treat a child as a victim, too, and if you can treat the offender and his victimization, i.e., where did you learn it, who taught you, who made you a victim, and you can have empathy for yourself, you have empathy for others. And when you think about raising a child, whose boo-boo gets kissed first? It isn't the mommy's, no. It is the child's, isn't it? So then the child imitates the mother, and that's where we learn empathy, isn't it?
Right.
By having people show empathy towards us. And if you cannot have empathy for yourself, you cannot have empathy for anyone else either. I can make you act as if you did. I can lock you up. I can be so miserable to you that eventually you will give in. But you won't give in willingly, and it won't mean anything, and you will reoffend.
Mm-hmm. You give children truth and hope. I understand. What does that mean?
Well, the truth is that we will get to the cause of your illness. We will get a correct diagnosis. If you've been in 50 places, obviously somebody missed something, right? Whatever other people have done hasn't worked. If I'm going to make a mistake, I'm going to make a new one. I'm going to make my mistake. I'm not going to do the same thing all over again. So we're going to search far and wide, read everything there is to read about you, talk to anyone who has ever known you to see whether we can come up with what it is that is the matter with you. And then we're going to teach you how to fix it.
You teach them how to fix
it. Yes. And we teach a method called the six boxes, and you're going to ask me about that, but
right.
it seems appropriate to talk about
Go,
that at this
please.
Point.
Yeah.
Which is a way of getting to what your trauma is, but not just getting to where your trauma is. Everyone has known that trauma makes you act badly. Mm-hmm. Trauma makes you feel bad, and then you act bad when you feel bad. Nobody screws up their life on purpose. I don't, and neither do you. Nobody does, neither do these kids. They are badly behaved for internal reasons. But everyone has known that for a long time. Freud knew that.
Sure.
Oedipus Rex knew that when he put his eyes out, right?
Right.
When he slept with his mother. It was not a good thing.
Right, no. right, right.
He was very upset about it. He just didn't know what to do about it. We tell you that you must do something about it. And then you have to find restorative justice for yourself. Mm-hmm. Not just because you were bad. Now, we make our children give restorative justice. That's a big deal right now. I do believe that that's also true. You do have to give restorative justice. But when you have been traumatized, you must also receive restorative justice.
Right.
And the children taught me that. They said to me, why should I pay when the people who've done this to me never paid?
That's
right. It seemed like a reasonable question to me. And I started thinking about that, and then my staff started thinking about it, and out of that has come the whole answer. You're right. You must get it as well as give it.
So you've been able to learn a lot from these young people, and
oh, God,
we should just
yes.
have Hildegard back for another half an hour at some point. So thank you so much for your time.
Is that it?
That's it.
That was fast.
It goes quite fast because of the great work that you've done. Thank you to Dr. Hildegard Messenbaugh for your great work over the years and for being our guest here with Mitch Morrissey on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. We'll see you next time.
Denver 8 TV, your city, your source.